A quick introduction to the British Council. We are the UK's international organization for cultural relations and educational opportunities. As you can see on the screen, our founding purpose was to create a friendly knowledge and understanding between the people of the UK and other countries. We have been working towards it in all the 110 countries that we operate in. We share UK's expertise, content, and experience to create opportunity for people worldwide. The three focus areas of our work are arts, education and society, and English and examinations. So we have had a quick look at the outcomes. Okay, so before the webinar, we had also requested you to take part in a pre-webinar survey. We received a lot of interesting responses from you. Let's take a quick look at those responses. The first question we asked was, what is assessment in the context of teaching and learning? And we have received many responses ranging from tests, to examinations, to role plays, to feedback with your students. We'll look at them in a minute in more details. And the second question was, we do not necessarily need assessment in the classroom. We asked you whether you agree with this statement or disagree. We'll look at these two in a minute. The third one was to check your feelings about being assessed. And unsurprisingly, most of the teachers feel positive about being assessed, with some being neutral about it. We had also asked you, why do you feel the way you feel, whether positive, negative, or neutral? So we received that it helps you in your professional development, in your skills enhancement, it's an opportunity to learn. Some of you also raised the importance of how it is managed and how it is portrayed. So interesting in responses there. Somebody has also raised the importance of sharing the outcomes with external stakeholders. For example, the parents, the students' parents. Lastly, we asked you, how do you think your students feel about being assessed? And the results are here. While quite a few of us feel that they feel positive after, this is still a bit of numbers that feel they are either neutral or negative about it. So we'll discover, we'll find out why. And actually, we had also asked you why, and you have raised issues around that it's sort of being mapped against each other's performance, being graded, being marked, and sort of labeling them as brilliant, not so good, etc. That's why they don't necessarily feel quite positive about it. So in today's webinar, we'll look at some of the ways how we can make them feel a bit more positive.
Some of our, one of our pre-webinar questions to you was around a statement which we'd asked you whether you agree or disagree. And we'd asked you why you do so. So based on your responses, we have some more teacher quotes here. And we're going to show you one quote at a time. Can you say whether you agree or disagree in the chat box, please? So can we have the first statement, please?
And also please tell us why.
Why do you agree and why do you disagree? Why do you feel what you feel? Thanks, Danish. So assessments create an unnecessary pressure on students. Do you agree with this statement or do you disagree? Could you please type this in the chat box and also support it with a reason why? Okay, Alia agrees with this statement. Okay, disagree. Because weaker students might not feel comfortable. Very true, Shama. It does create a pressure on weaker students. Okay, can you support your answer with a reason, please? Ah, very true. Somebody said that
the
assessment is more. Arpit Kothari. Thanks, Arpit. So when you have too many assessments, it creates unnecessary pressure on students.
Yeah, and somebody has raised the issues around the stressful environment.
Yeah, involves stress, true. Yeah. Okay, that's nice.
Let's go to the next one.
To the next one now. assessments help us know how well students are learning. What do you think about this one? Okay. When the form of assessment is not interesting, formative assessments do help, I agree, yeah?
Now let's start to look at the next one, assessment.
Yeah, okay, what about the third one? Can we have the third statement, please? It is essential to assess students regularly to establish accountability. This is an interesting one. What do you think about this one? Okay. So most of you say yes. It is important to establish accountability, right? Okay, but whose accountability are we talking about? Okay, ours and our learners, very true. Teachers and students, yes. I think we're all very clear about this. Should we move to the fourth one now? Assessments help me make need-based classroom decisions. So do you rely on your assessments to help you decide on your next classroom routine? Excellent. Okay, to some extent. Wonderful. So most of you feel positive about this. You agree with this. Okay, let's move to the next one. Okay, this came from one of our participants. I think we do not need any assessments beyond scheduled tests and exams in the academic calendar. What about this statement? So you only need your semester exams and your unit tests, no other assessments at all. Uh-huh, we need formative assessments along the way, absolutely. Disagree, okay, so unanimous disagreement there. That's great. Academic exams must be broken down to smaller tests. It should be a continuous process, okay. And the final one, assessment is not a one-off event, but a part of everyday classroom teaching. Do you agree with this one? I think this kind of, yeah. So most of you agree with this. This kind of contradicts the previous one. Yeah, so everybody who disagreed to the previous one would have agreed to this one. Brilliant. Statements around assessment. So how do you assess students? This was another question we'd asked you in the pre-webinar task. And we've tried to categorize your responses and we've tried to kind of get the common ones together. So here are the responses. We got a range of them. Some of you said oral tests is a way to do it. Worksheets, tasks, semester exams, observation, open book tests, etc. Can you categorize these ways of assessing students? Do you think it falls under two broad categories? Any guesses which are the categories that these fall under? Let's look at oral tests. So which category do you think oral test falls under? Which category of assessment? Formative and summative. Any other categories you can think of? Anything that comes to mind?
Yeah, when I think we're looking at approaches to assessment.
Approaches to assessment. Any approaches that come to mind? Wonderful. I saw somebody, Suyog's written AFL and AOL. Okay, what do you mean by AFL? Can you please elaborate? What's the full form for everybody's benefit?
I'll give it away.
Brilliant, yes. Let's give it away. So assessment of learning and assessment for learning. AOL stands for assessment of learning and AFL stands for assessment for learning. Is what you've told us. We've got some of these here, which we thought would be assessment of learning and for learning, depending on how it is conducted. For example, tasks. Depends on what task you set up. It could fall under AOL or AFL. Similarly, making presentations. Worksheets. The way you design your worksheets will decide whether you're doing it for AOL or AFL. And the same is the case with role plays. We have a couple of definitions here. Have a quick read through. The first one is up on the slide. And can you identify the key features of AFL? Excellent. Assessment for learning is the process of seeking and interpreting evidence for use by learners and their teachers to decide where the learners are in their learning, where they need to go, and how best to get there. So based on these two definitions and based on your definitions as well, can we quickly identify some key features of AFL? And you can type it in the chat box, please. So right there, key features of AFL. It is an approach to teaching and learning, and therefore is a feature of everyday classroom practice. So it's an ongoing process, like most of you said. It's a way to collect evidence and feedback to decide the direction of teaching, which leads to improved learning outcomes, and therefore needs an active participation from both learners and the teacher. So both parties are equally involved and actively involved in this. Excellent. It's helpful in making students become more confident in expected learning outcomes and standards thereof, and therefore being better able to chart their learning path. It's an effective tool to inform teaching approaches and making changes therein to better meet the learning needs and preferences, and therefore leading to a more rewarding and memorable learning experience. That's, I think, the key that we want, right? A memorable learning experience for our learners.
So now we'll look at some of the ways to use assessment for learning in our classroom. So thinking about the kind of activities we looked at in the slide from the pre-webinar task, and looking at some of the features we have discussed, can you think about how we can use assessment for learning in our classroom? Great. So as we can see, there are different ways to do it. We'll look at five of them, broad ones today, and we'll focus there. So the first one that we are looking at today is asking questions, monitoring and listening actively, encouraging self and peer assessment, giving developmental feedback, and using some of the ways for assessment of learning in a more learning friendly manner. So these are the five ways that we focus today. Let's move on. So now look at all the five techniques that we've got here for assessment for learning. We'll give you 1 minute to key in your responses. And for each of these, we'll look at them one by one. You have to answer three broad questions. The first one is, so for example, if we're looking at asking questions, we'll have to think about how we can use this in our classrooms. Secondly, we'll think about what could be some of the possible advantages of asking questions in classroom to assess for learning. And thirdly, imagine if I'm a teacher who would like to start using this technique in my classroom, what tips would you like to give me to do it more effectively? So asking questions is an effective way to find out how much learners know about a topic. So I'll listen. And further, to check the understanding of what we have taught. So the finding the gap between teaching and learning. And as you were saying, when we ask questions effectively, we are actually helping our students develop their higher order thinking skills, which gradually lead to help them become more autonomous and lifelong learners. Furthermore, I also feel that when we ask effective questions, we are also promoting a habit to make our students curious. And they tend to ask more questions in return as well, which help them find answers on their own. A few quick tips for teachers to use questioning more effectively. Somebody has raised open questions. They're of course important, but closed questions are particularly effective to check and stand them. So we need to make this decision when we should use open and when we should use closed questions. Thinking time, of course, very important. So they need some time to process and articulate their response. So allow them that little time. This is something that I feel was not really covered in what we saw in our chat. Sometimes what we observe in classes is that a few selected students get more opportunities to answer, maybe because they are more active and they are more keen to answer. We need to think how we can give equal opportunities to different learners. Some of the ways here could be asking students to nominate each other instead of you picking them. Allowing them time is of course helpful as well. Another thing you could try is ask them all to raise their hands if they've got the answer right. And then ask them to answer a little later. So you're actually giving them time in two different ways. Most times as a teacher, we feel that it's my duty to tell learners whether the answer is right or not. That doesn't have to be the case all the time. So you can ask and you can encourage learners to react to each other's answers. What do you think about this? Do you agree here? And really important to remember, while the right answers tell us what they have learned or understood, the wrong ones tell us where the gap is and help us identify those gaps. And hence they're equally important, if not more. So it's also important to help your learners see the role that questions play in the process of teaching and learning and how the right questions can lead us to finding answers and areas we need to work further. So monitoring learners while they're on a task. So you set up a task, you allow them some time, and then you monitor. It gives us a real insight into how much they've understood of a topic, how well they're able to apply this knowledge to move towards the successful completion of that specific task, and any areas they might be unclear about. Similarly, so when we ask them a question and they talk to us, or even in general, when we listen actively to a learner's responses and ask questions effectively, it gives us a lot of help in understanding their learning needs, and which in turn informs our teaching practice. So these are the two areas we're looking at here. A few tips for teachers, and I can see responses coming in. Yes, a few tips for us here. We need to realize that monitoring can be daunting to learners. So when your teacher comes and stands right next to you, it's a little unnerving at times and you tend to shut up. So learn and find ways to do it a little discreetly. Something that I find particularly useful is to stand at a little distance and observe from there. Another way to do it could be to stand behind their backs. So you're not facing them, you're silently standing there and observing from there. Another thing that I at times do is, I stand close to one student and I observe somebody a little distant. So that's another way to do it a little discreetly. Mm-hmm. Very important, as we discussed while talking about asking questions, always allow some time to learners to get along the task before we start to monitor. If I start to observe and monitor right after setting up the task, it might actually deviate them from the task. They might become too cautious of my presence, so it might actually affect their learning negatively. So remember to do it a little later when they've started to feel more confident with the task. We all know teacher memory is a fantastic tool, but then to make it even more effective, we can silently use the sticky notes to capture our findings by this observation. And somebody has raised this in the chat box. They said to find errors, which is of course an important aspect. We should also find and make a note of what they are doing well, what their strengths are, because it's important. They need to keep developing those strong areas as well while they work on their areas for development. So not just errors, errors as well as the areas of strength. Yeah, that was the next point actually. Yeah. So don't be just focused on learner errors and mistakes. We must also make a conscious effort to find things they are doing well and highlight them. So after we've got all of this data, we've got all of these notes, we have found their strengths and areas for development, a very good idea is to discuss them with the learners and ask them to find what they feel their strengths are, what is it that they would like to work further on. We'll look at this in a little while, how we can co-plan our lessons with them based on this data. So let's look at what we've got here. So as we have covered all of this, we'll not spend much time. But important to remember that when we ask them to assess their peers and share that feedback with each other, they also enhance their social skills. So one way to introduce this could be your student journal or learning logs. You can of course name it something more fun. So some of the questions that you can put in there: what I found easy, difficult, what helped me learn, what I'm going to do, continue to do or do differently. Somebody had raised this about constructive feedback. So it's very important, especially in terms of peer assessment, that we make sure we first of all set up this practice of giving feedback more positively and constructively. And as a teacher, we model this. Really important for us.
We'll have a quick look at what we've got. So which stage of the lesson? So it is the stage where learners and their teacher work together and to talk about the present stage of learning, where they want to get to and how they will get there. So there is a clear plan in place, and feedback helps overcome any barriers to learning and fills any gap between teaching and learning. And therefore it leads to better learning outcomes. So whatever gaps you have between teaching and learning, your feedback helps to cover those gaps and it helps your learners to improve in their learning outcomes. Here are some tips for you. So while assigning a task, I think this is something we really, really believe at in the British Council. It's important to discuss its aims and what will success look like at the end of it. So at the end of it, how will you rate them? What will be the evaluation parameters? It's important to discuss it at the onset of the task itself so that it's clear to the students and so that they can perform accordingly. Discuss the criteria you will use to evaluate their work. Very true. When you give them marks and grades, you usually shift your focus from the teacher's comments. I think it would be really nice for you to supplement it with some comments. Okay, so if you've got an 8 out of 10, why have you got it? You've done this really well. And maybe here are a couple of areas where you could probably look at improving your work. So if you're looking at AFL, comments are more useful than marks. Structuring your feedback with focus on the task and not the learner. Many a times we get carried away by the quality of the learner and we give them feedback on you know, suppose I've heard feedback comments like, how was the class today? It was very good. The teacher was excellent. What does that mean? It's not structured feedback, right? It's not focused also on the task. So when you're giving feedback to students, your use of the adjectives was very good, for example. Your use of the present continuous tense was very good in today's essay. Things like that, which are very focused and structured feedback. Personal praise is not quite helpful in learning. I know many of you would disagree with this, but we're not here to give them personal praise. It doesn't really support their learning outcomes.
Yeah. What I would add here is personal praise might actually boost their confidence, etc.
Yeah.
When it comes to learning, it's better that our feedback is focused on the task.
Making AOL learning friendly. Now, all of us know that we have our constraints in the system that we work in. We cannot completely do away with AOL, right? So we can try and make AOL more learning friendly than what it is probably currently, and try and work around what we have. Okay, so that's exactly what I told you right at the beginning. Exams are a part of the school education system, and with some bit of thinking, we can surely use it to support learning more effectively. We can't completely do away with it. Much as I would like it, much as you would like it, we can't completely do away with exams. A slight change in approach might not only help learners do better, but also change their perception of exams. So here are a few tips to use tests and exams to support learning. Before the exam, help learners reflect on their strengths and areas of development. Encourage them to plan how they can work on the areas of development in particular. So this needs to be done right before the exam, not when you're sharing their papers with them, not when you're giving away the grades, right? Discuss how exams can help them identify their strengths and help them plan their further learning. There's usually this negative connotation around exams. It's important to break that and tell them that it will help them plan their further learning and kind of get them to befriend the exam monster.
Yeah, and what can help them tackle this monster?
After the exam, allow learners to look at their marked answers and identify which areas they were able to score marks and where they need more clarity to be able to do better. This, I think, really promotes learner autonomy because you are giving them the freedom to go into their answers, go through it, see where they've done well, identify areas of development. So really promotes learner autonomy in the classroom, makes them accountable for their own learning, and encourage peer discussion to help learners clarify any minor misunderstandings and gaps. This links back to what Danish mentioned in self and peer assessment. Many a times we want to give it all to them. So maybe time to step back and let the peers take some action. And do we have one more here?
Yeah.
So spend time to find out which areas most students did well and areas that need more work. You could discuss this with them and co-plan upcoming sessions. Brilliant. So it's all about discussing with them, sitting down with them and talking to them about what they did well. And most of them, if they've done well in some area, you know that all of them have understood that. And if there is an area which most of them are struggling with, you know where you need to work towards.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
And it also makes your classroom so much more fun. Learners feel they are part of the learning process. They are not just being taught. So yeah. I think it changes the whole dynamics of a classroom.
The classroom, yeah, true. I'm going to read out the first scenario. Listen to this and please let us know how the teacher can make this assessment scenario more effective. You need to decide whether it is effective. And let us know how it can be made more effective. Nikhat teaches classes 7 and 8. She has noticed that when she grades papers and returns them to the students, they simply accept the grade and refuse her invitation for them to improve their score. "Thank you very much," they'll say, "but I'm fine with my C." So do you think this is a very pleasant situation? Okay, so some suggestions that we have for Nikhat's scenario, very, very similar to what you've shared in the chat box. Students may not find Nikhat's offer to help to be genuine. That's probably why they're refusing her help. Nikhat could have probably offered to help beforehand while students were preparing for the exam. While talking about assessments and exams, she could also discuss its aims and what success will look like at completion. This is what one of you pointed out rightly in the chat box. I think Ram pointed it out, yeah. She could discuss the criteria she would use to evaluate their work. I think one of you again mentioned this too. Brilliant. She can start writing comments for students along with the grades and marks. Yes, this also was there in the chat box. Looks like we've copied your answers now. Okay, so this is scenario number two. We have a different teacher, Santosh. Santosh is a teacher of English for classes 9 and 10. He's not sure if all the students in his class have understood a particular concept well. Most of the times, the same ones raise their hands, and Santosh ends up nominating from among these students. Even if he gives the others an opportunity, he has realized that he's beginning to lose patience. He ends up answering the questions himself. While he ends up acknowledging the right answers, he doesn't know what to do when students give incorrect answers. Most of his students, however, do well in exams. What do you think, what is Santosh's problem here? And how can he probably make it better? How can he improve? Okay, some suggestions here. Allow thinking time before eliciting answers. Think of ways to give equal opportunities to all the learners. I read about this somewhere online very recently. You can get them to do a little thumbs up instead of doing a hands up. You could get them to do just a thumbs up so that they're not afraid of answering and not everybody in the class notices that their hands are not up. And the teacher then nominates. If they feel that they're confident, their thumb goes up and, you know, they feel a little more confident. This was in one of the Edutopia videos that I watched. Allow learners to react to their peers' answers, while right answers tell us what learners know.
Yeah.
So like Danish said, it's important to establish that it's okay to be wrong. It's okay to give wrong answers. It tells you that you need to work in that area a little more. So it's all about establishing that atmosphere in the classroom.
Yeah.
Moving to scenario number three. Okay, so this is another teacher, Prajakta, who teaches young learners. She's discovered that reteaching something that students were not able to score good marks in tests and exams is more challenging than starting from the point of questions. I think it's a challenge. Unlearning is a big challenge for all of us. She's noticed that students lose interest in revision classes as she tries to explain difficult concepts and challenging areas after tests and exams. She also feels her students are way too dependent on her. Prajakta would like them to take more responsibility of their learning, but doesn't know where to start. Can we help Prajakta? How can we help her? Mostly covered here. Prajakta could think about how observing her learners while they work on tasks could help identify areas that they are confident and where they might need more support. One way to keep students' interest might be to encourage students to identify areas they need more work and to co-plan any revision classes to address those areas. A way to make students more autonomous is by allowing them to assess their own and peers' work. It was their peer assessments. It will gradually allow them independence and make them take responsibility of their learning. She could further consider introducing student journals or learning logs to help her learners develop confidence and skills of self-assessment. For peer assessment, however, she would need to model and help students give feedback in a positive and constructive manner. Yeah, very, very important. Before we jump into peer assessments, we need to set it up and ensure that it happens in the smoothest possible way. Otherwise, it could actually turn really bad than do good to the student. Wonderful. Inviting feedback on the activities she uses in the class might be a good place to start. Yeah. So to find out.
Sure. So broadly speaking, as we discussed today, there are two approaches to assessment: assessment of learning and assessment for learning. They both have their own roles to play, of course. Today we focused on assessment for learning. It's an approach to teaching and learning. It's not so much of a testing. It's not testing at all, to be honest. It's a part of your teaching and it helps learning in your classroom. So it's a part of your everyday classroom practice. It leads to learners taking responsibility of their own learning, and the teacher guides them through this journey. Some of the ways that we discussed today to use assessment for learning in our classes include asking questions, monitoring and listening actively, encouraging self and peer assessment, giving developmental feedback, and using assessment of learning in a more learning supportive manner. While teachers start planning using assessment for learning, if you are starting new, if you've been doing it for a while, you could start to consider writing a journal to document your journeys. This journal could help us in making our future decisions, building from our past learning. And it's a useful tool to further enhance your skills and support your peers' professional development, that you share learning with each other. So you could think of sharing that journal with each other, or you could actually publish it, if not in a physical form, publish it online using a blog. Yeah, that's what we have got here. Now,
Danish, what would you say? I think an effective feedback form certainly needs to cover what you expect, what you've actually given input on. So if I've delivered a session and I need to know what the aims of the session are, so the feedback form certainly needs to capture feedback around those aims and not go off on a tangent asking for feedback on something totally different. That's one key area I would certainly look for in a feedback form.
Yeah. And I would think the questions should be formed in a manner which promote reflection. So you using your feedback, feedback form, you make them reflect on the learning.
Absolutely. And I think they need to be specific as well. Yeah. So I cannot say, did you improve after this session? That shouldn't be a question on a feedback form, I would say.
Yeah, so could you give us a little more specific one for this, Priya?
Has this session helped you improve in your assessment literacy, or has this session helped you develop your understanding of assessment for learning? And then you have parameters around it, probably.
Yeah. And thinking about the context of our learners, you might also include some questions which build onto their learning and ask them how they plan to apply it.
Sure.
So for example, if I say, what have you gained from this session? How it will help you in your learning, how it will help you, for example, being more effective in writing a letter, for example.
Sure.
And very important to not focus only on areas which were well.
Yeah.
Balance it with areas for development as well.
Sure. So it should capture suggestions from the feedback provider on how the person could do better the next time.
I think not a very easy.
It's a tricky one to answer.
They both have their own function, and especially in the context of a formal education, it's definitely.
I think it's important to strike a balance there. To kind of use it both in a way that it informs each other. So your formative ones or the assessment for learning ones could inform how you plan your lessons and where they're, where, you know, to fill in the missing gaps. Whereas your AOL ones, unfortunately or fortunately, help you in giving them those grades that they need to go to the next level.
And the real world.
Yeah, in the real world, unfortunately. So probably striking a balance is the key.
I think it's also important to realize that AFL is a part of your day-to-day classroom teaching.
So it's not a one-off thing, yeah.
Yeah. So you don't really have to think about how often I should do this. Ideally, we should be doing this in each lesson. And eventually, it will lead our learners to better learning, which will help them do better in their AOL, hopefully. Personal praise. So what we're trying to say is, when a learner completes a task, and for example, you say, I've never heard this one, so I'll use my name here. Danish, you're brilliant. it's definitely helpful in
boosting Danish's confidence.
Yeah, and maybe making me become more confident. But then it does not really tell me what it is that I've done well. So it does not really result in helping me to learn better next time or to continue to do what I'm doing well. So as against this, if my teacher says, Danish, the structure of your essay was really effective. So I know that I've structured it well. Yeah. So instead of just giving a personal praise, AFL is more effective when we make it more specific to the task they do well or they want to improve further.
So obviously, assessment of learning, I think we've aced it. We can do it with a class of 200 as well. Mm-hmm. But assessment for learning, like Danish mentioned, I don't think it's a one-off thing. It is something which is embedded into your everyday teaching learning. So if you do it through, putting students into groups when you teach them or conducting revision activities, I know it's a challenge in Indian classrooms and in our context to deal with large classes, but we do have techniques to deal with large classes as well. So you could conduct it as a group assessment. You could do it as, if it's a speaking task, you could get them to do 1-minute jam sessions where you have a group speaking to each other. You could do a group discussion and find out if they're doing well. And I think you could do it in an ongoing basis with classrooms and divide it and plan it and do it in a better way rather than not do it at all. Would you like to add something?
Yeah, and I think much like anything else, it will take us a little time to gain confidence in, for example, using questions with a large group. But gradually we'll realize that using these techniques is actually making learning not just more effective, but also easier to manage the large group.